So in today's lecture on applied mathematical finance, we continue our session on interest rates. And yeah, from the very first lecture, maybe we will make use of the universal pricing theorem so that we can value financial products or cash flows by taking a conditional expectation with respect to some special measure, the equivalent martingale measure. Once we have divided the cash flow by the corresponding numerea, yeah, so this numerea is associated with this measure, the objects become martingales, and this is here the universal pricing theorem. And in our session on interest rates, I already introduced basic interest rates, and the basic object that we used for this was the value of a zero coupon bond. So here is the definition. So we have a payment of one unit of currency. So actually, I should maybe write the unit here, carbon currency, at a future point in time, T2. And then I ask myself, what is the value at time little t, okay, and the value that corresponds to this is maybe smaller, so, and this is called the zero coupon bond price, so that we observe in time little t. And t mapping to p of t2 semicolon t is a stochastic process, so that object is allowed to change randomly. And our definitions of interest rates were based on this idealized object. And one big idealization was that we considered everything to be risk-free. So risk-free, not in the sense that there's no interest rate risk, there's no stochasticity. So of course there is interest rate risk, interest rates are now stochastic, but risk-free in the sense of issuer default. Yeah. So if the bond is issued by some issuer, we assume that there's no default. So this guy doesn't go bankrupt. So it is guaranteed that we receive this amount. Yeah? So I will at this in this section not consider issuer default, which will then, if you consider it, result in multiple interest rate curves. Every issuer may have a different interest rate curve. And so based now on our zero coupon bond, we could define the forward bond, which was actually just the ratio of two zero coupon bonds, which was corresponding here to some trading strategy. Yeah, so invest in one and borrow the money by the other. And that then motivated the definition of an interest rate. So we defined several different versions of interest rates. And one version that we defined was here the simple rate, and in this case the forward rate, and sometimes it's also called LIBOR because that is just the quoting convention of the LIBOR rate. Okay, that is just a historic name, so I will maybe call it just the simple forward rate. so rate here means that I measure it relative to time. So rate means that the unit of this object, so if this is the symbol for the physical unit, yeah, like meter per second squared, this is one divided by time. And it's not one currency divided by time, because actually I divide here two portfolios. So this has the unit currency, and this has the unit currency. Yeah, so it is the relative, the ratio of two currency objects. And yeah, what is it? It is the bond at the beginning, which is, if interest rates are positive, has a larger value than the bond at the end. So minus the bond at the end in relation, so in percentage, to the value of the bond at the end. Yeah. So how do you, how much do you gain by this strategy, which was here our strategy for the forward bond. Yeah. So how much do you gain per time? So per time, this was here then the period length that defined this per time. Okay, so we defined this object, this interest rate object, and it was just an alternative way of expressing the interest rate curve. So the zero coupon bond price curve, maybe, by performing a discretization in two small intervals. And then one other object I introduced was the rolling bond. So that was some kind of investment strategy. So while the zero coupon bond was, if I receive one unit in the future, what is today's value? This here is actually, if I invest one unit at some initial time, say T0, so I invest one unit here. So I have one unit at this point. So, and then I invest this in the next zero coupon bond. So I will receive some kind of interest here. And then I reinvest this in the next zero coupon bond and I will receive interest on the amount that I have received. So what is then the value at these points here? And actually we could also write the value at all intermediate points by observing, okay, what is the product we invest in? We invest in the zero coupon bond that matures at the next point in time. Yeah. So if this is little t, then the tmt plus one is t2. Yeah. So the zero coupon bond that matures in the next endpoint here. Yeah. So this here is the tmt plus one. Okay, and this strategy gave us another financial product, which was some kind like a bank account, which accrues money, but now discretized by this tenor structure, which we call it, which described the bonds in which we invest. And then we could define another interest rate, which was now based on this product. So I call this product now R of T. Given that I have some time discretization, the capital TIs, I can ask, okay, if I invest one unit in T0, what is the money I have in this account in R of T? And then we could define the performance of this account. So what do we have at the end of an interval from S to T minus what did we had at the beginning of the interval? So at the point S, so RS, RT minus RS, divided by what was the value that we had in the beginning. So this is the percentage amount we have in excess to what we have in the beginning. And then we divide by the time period, so T minus S. So that was also a rate. So it was also per time. Yeah, so it was also a rate, and it is the performance of this accrual account. And so while the forward rate was looking forward to an interval, yeah, and we defined it by going backwards, so we had the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. Now this product goes forward, and then I ask myself backward, what is the rate that I have realized? So this here is somehow the rate we have realized. By going from S to T, and the forward rate is somehow the rate that I expect, yeah, by going from T1 to T2. Yeah, it is this rate here is FT1 measurable. We observe it then in FT1. Yeah, so if I place a little t to T1, yeah, so it is the bond from the beginning to the end, and this here is going backward. So we had these two different rates, and there was for this backward looking rate one nice little lemma. It was that the expectation of what you get at the end. So the expectation of receiving this performance of the accrual account at the end. So at the end means the payment time is capital T, which means if I want to value this cash flow or this value, I have to divide by N of T, my numerator. So now I go to my risk neutral measure. So if I value this in at the beginning of the period, then this was equal to just the forward rate observed at the beginning of the period. So this here is the condition time, S, yeah, which appears here. And this now is the formulation that I see L as the expectation of what you get on the interval from S to T, and I is what you realize by this investment strategy. And it could be that in this interval from, say, S to T, your investment strategy actually has much finer intervals. Yeah, so it could be that your bank account, your rolling bond uses a much finer interval, because if you just have one interest rate, yeah, then this result is trivial because then the two agree by definition, but this also holds in expectation. And I forgot that I have to multiply with the numerator at the condition time. Yeah? So there is an N of S in front here, the evaluation time. Yeah, so that is on our universal pricing theorem. Okay, so there's a nice relation between this backward looking rate or backward rate, which is the performance of the accrual account, and the forward rate, which we will use in this today's session, because we will actually look a little bit on financial products that pay this amount. But since I have this relation, everything also holds for financial products that pay the backward rate. Okay, so that was this section on the backward rate. And now I'd like to start with some more advanced products, still simple interest rate products. And I believe we already started a little bit. Yeah, the first point was already part of the last lecture, the fixed coupon bond. So this is my program for today. I will define some basic interest rate products, and I will also discuss how is the valuation of these products, what is the value of this these products. And in this section, actually, to evaluate the financial product, we do not need a mathematical model for the stochastic processes. So here we can perform valuation without specifying a model for the stochastic process. So for the stochastic processes, say for the PTs or for the L, say L from S to T, so whatever you have, yeah, except for the initial value. So it means that all valuation can be expressed in terms of these objects observed at valuation time. And it's just a simple formula. To some sense, the reason is that there is some kind of linearity. Yeah. So expectation operator is a linear operator. And now these objects, they have some kind of martingale property. Yeah. The zero Cooper bond divided by the numerator is a martingale. And then if you have linearity, yeah, so then in the payoffs, then this results in the fact that you just need the martingale property and you just don't need to know the underlying stochastic process. And later in another section, we will also look at more complicated products where we require a model for our stochastic processes. So for the SDEs. For our financial products. Okay, so our basic product is still the zero Cooper bond, and we define now other products, which can be expressed in terms of some linear combinations of these zero Cooper bonds. So first simple example is the Cooper bond. Yeah. So as I mentioned, the zero Cooper bond is an idealization. So maybe this object doesn't even exist on the market. It's some kind of atomic object that is useful in our calculations. And the Cooper bond pays intermediate coupons. So I have some coupon here, CI, and the coupon is also understood as relative to the period length, so specified in 5% per year, maybe something like that. So we have an additional payment here in every period from TI to TI plus one. So the product looks like that. We have CI times TI plus one minus TI paid in. So the payment time is the end of the period. So paid in the end of the period. So in TI plus one. So, and then this payment is repeated for every period here. And at the end, there is an additional payment of one. So in the last period from TN minus one to TN, so this is TN, there is this final payment of one unit. Okay, and you see that this is just a portfolio of zero Cooper bonds. And since we assume that all payments are linear in their notional, so the sum of two financial products has the value of the sum of the values. So we can just value this by valuing each zero bond in this portfolio individually. Actually, in mathematical finance, there are sometimes contexts where this relation no longer holds. I have a remark at the end. Yeah, it's maybe also related to issuer default. Yeah, but actually now I assume that I have this also form of linearity. Yeah, so that the sum of the individual objects can be valued by valuing each individual object and taking the sum. So I immediately know how to value this coupon bond. It's just the value of each individual payment multiplied with the corresponding coupon zero bond at the payment time. Okay, so that here is the zero coupon bond at the payment time. The payment time of this amount here. Okay, so the value is just this amount, which is a constant. Yeah, so it's just a notional of this zero bond plus the additional payment here of one unit at the end. Yeah? So this is the value of the coupon bond. So the value of the coupon bond. Yeah? So seen in time little t. Yeah? So in evaluation time little t. So maybe on the left-hand side, you could also write the properties or the CIs and the time discretization. So you see the valuation is here performed in time little t, and this is also the time that you plug in here. Yeah? So I can express the value of the coupon bond by these zero bonds. I already made this remark that if you observe bond prices, coupon bond prices on the market, there is a small difference. Yeah, so sometimes they quote the clean price. So what we calculate here is the dirty price, the price of all future payments. And this clean price is just an adjustment to remove the jump, but it's usually a deterministic formula. Yeah, it is a deterministic formula that just somehow smoothens this value. And it's just a quoting convention. Okay, that just as a remark that you have to be a little bit careful if you observe prices on the market. There are sometimes conventions, yeah, that modify the price. Not so interesting for us in this section. Okay, so this this adjustment is the so-called accrued interest. So now I like to look at another financial product. Instead of paying the constant CI in every period, I would like to pay now the forward rate. So I like to pay here the forward rate LI. So LI is L from for the period from TI to TI plus one. Fixed at the beginning of the period. So this object here is a random variable. So it is FTI measurable. So I observe this random variable at TI, so it is at least, yeah, FTI measurable. So maybe it is also measurable with a smaller t, but it's not guaranteed, yeah? Usually not. So I pay a random object, a stochastic quantity, and I ask myself, okay, what is the value of this object today? So this, since this is a rate, I multiply with the period length. So that part here is just multiplication with a constant, and that here is the notional, which is also just a constant. The notional I multiply. So, but now I like to pay this. And when do we pay it? I pay it at the end of the period. So this looks like, yeah, this looks like this. Here is our time axis, and we have different periods, TI to TI plus one, TI plus two. And at the end of a period, we pay a quantity. And now I draw this like maybe this here. And the quantity is not a constant, it is stochastic. So that's why I draw it like this, so a little bit wiggling, yeah. And actually here I only consider the coupon payments. So this is not the floating rate bond. The floating rate bond would have an additional payment at the end. So if you have something like this here, then it would be the floating rate bond, the floater bond. But in this section, we know how to value this constant payment. So I just look at this, at these coupons. So we pay these coupons here from the period starts in T1, The first payment is in T2 and it runs to Tn. So I have n minus one payments. So that is my definition here of this object. Yeah, so just the floating rate coupons. And now I ask, what is the value of this? And surprisingly, the value at the future, at an earlier time, little t, has to be f little t measurable. So it has to be some kind of expectation. Surprisingly, I can calculate it without actually modeling the random variable. And the reason becomes obvious now in our little proof. So what we will prove is the value of the floater. So the value of the floater seen in time little t is just the sum of the payments. So my payment was L, so the sum of the payments multiplied with here these constants. Okay, so that is trivial. Multiplied with the zero Cooper bond. So multiplied with the zero Cooper bond that corresponds to the payment time. So that was here the payment time. So it is like paying a constant, but of course, since these objects are random variables, what I just pay has to be f little t measurable. So there has to be the little t also on the right hand side. So this is the zero Cooper bond observed in little t, but this is also our definition of the forward rate observed in little t. So it is actually the initial value of the stochastic process. So this is a funny result. So it means that paying this stochastic quantity at a future point in time, namely ti plus one, is like paying a constant at this point in time, namely the constant corresponding to the initial value of the stochastic process. And if you put in the definition of L, you actually know that, okay, so where should I write this? Here, you know that, sorry. So if you now plug in the definition of the L, so what was L? L from Ti to Ti plus one multiplied with T, the period length. Okay, L was one divided by the period length multiplied with the bond at the beginning, Ti minus the bond at the end, Ti plus one divided by the bond at the end. Yeah, so you see that here, there is the bond at the end appearing. And you see that this is actually a telescope sum. This is actually a telescope sum. And I get that it's just the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. Okay, this object has a nice little formula. Okay, there's a small error here. Yeah, so there should be the little t there. So maybe I just add this. So let me maybe remove here a little bit and fix the equation, though that is observed in little t, observed in little t. Okay. So bond at the beginning of the period discretization minus bond at the end of the period discretization observe today. And as I mentioned, we can express the value in terms of objects we observe today, linear combination of the zero bonds. So let's prove this little result. So since this is just a sequence of payments, it's enough to just value one payment. So we value here just one payment I. So this is just one part of our sum then. Yeah. So, and I pay, I value the period. From Ti to Ti plus one. So what do we pay in this period? I pay the notional N multiplied with the forward rate. The forward rate fixed at the beginning of the period. Okay. Multiplied with the period length. Now I already wrote the definition of L is 1 divided by the period length multiplied with. So what do we have? It is the bond at the beginning of the period minus the bond at the end of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period. And everything is multiplied with the notional. So what we observe here is that since the fixing time, so the point when we actually stop our stochastic process and say, okay, that is the payment, is the TI, so it is fixed at the beginning of the period. This object here is an FTI measurable random variable. Yeah, so we already had this. This is FTI measurable. So it means that I have here TI, and here is the payment point, TI plus one. So I pay something in TI plus one. So we pay something here. But in between the interval from TI to TI plus one, what we pay is a constant. Because conditional to TI, I know what we get. So it means that I can actually calculate the value at an earlier point in time, say maybe at this point here, say little t, by using this amount. So this amount here, so using this amount and multiply with the zero coupon bond that pays at the end of the period. So that is the zero coupon bond corresponding to the payment time observed in little t. Yeah. So the only thing I cannot do is to move this point here beyond this line. Yeah. So do not cross the line TI. So that is forbidden. Yeah. So that would be forbidden. Because before TI, it is a stochastic object. But after TI, it is known and I can multiply with the zero coupon bond. So I just multiply this with the zero coupon bond and I can move the little t to the beginning of the period. So if I move the little t to the beginning of the period, it means I multiply this guy here with PTI plus one observed in PTI and this guy cancels. Okay, so this means I know the value of the floater at the beginning of the period. So the value of the floater at the beginning of the period. So here I have the value of the floater coupon, yeah, at the end of the period when it is paid. But I know that this value corresponds to just the green circle multiplied with the zero coupon bond. So it corresponds to actually just notional multiplied with this here at the beginning of the period. And now you see that at the beginning of the period, I just have a portfolio of two financial products, namely the bond that pays one unit at the beginning of the period. So that is actually a one minus the bond that pays one unit at the end of the period. So I have a portfolio of financial products and I know what is the value of this portfolio today. It is just the value which I observe today. So today it is just the same portfolio, the bond at the beginning, that pays at the beginning of the period minus the bond that pays at the end of the period. And now I can plug in my definition of L again. So while here we started using the definition of L to get to the bonds, I do the same backward. And I have that this is L multiplied with the bond that pays one unit at the end of the period. So it is just the initial value of this forward rate. So you see, I have proven the valuation by just considering a financial product, a portfolio of financial products that generate the corresponding value. Yeah. So first argument was paying at the end of this quantity is like paying in the beginning this quantity multiplied with the zero coupon bond price. And then I observed that this corresponded to a portfolio of 2 0 coupon bonds. And so I know that the value before any point is just this portfolio. As we will see later, there is a special structure here behind this. The payment time actually has a correspondence to the object that is paid. Yeah? So what is happening here does not happen if you modify, for example, the payment time. So if you pay L at a different time. I have a second version of the proof, and this version is maybe less illustrative. I just use the universal pricing theorem. So I know I have a payment, and this payment occurs in time ti plus one. So I have a payment that occurs in time ti plus one. So I know that this is the value in ti plus one. So I know the value at an earlier time is just divide this by the numerator at ti plus one. Yeah. So the numerator always corresponds to the payment time or the evaluation time inside this expectation. And then it gives you outside this by applying the expectation, the value at an earlier point in time. So just take the expectation with respect to the risk neutral measure of the floater coupon payment divided by the numerator. So now I choose a very special numerator. So my numerator that I choose here, the N, is the zero coupon bond that corresponds to the payment time. Because if I choose this special numerator, then the numerator at payment time will be equal to one. Yeah. So here I divide by the numerator at payment time. And if I choose that numerator, it is equal to one at payment time. So I just take the expectation of the floater of the floater coupon payment. Okay, and maybe I have to apologize here a little bit. So sorry for the notation, for the bad notation. Sorry for the ambiguity. Yeah, so I use the symbol N of T for the numerator. And I also use the symbol N for the notional. Yeah, so here you see I have this N for the notional. So maybe I should have used a different symbol for the notional. Yeah, so I could have used here an M instead. Then that guy here would be an M. That guy would be an M. That guy would be an M. And also here in your in your theorem and in your definition, it would be an M. But so maybe I hope that you can live with this, and I don't need this modification. Yeah. So if there is an off T, it is the numerator. Yeah. So maybe I can improve this slide next time. Okay, so now N of little t is my numerator. So it is the numerator at evaluation time. So we evaluate this here in little t. So I have to perform conditional expectation conditional to little t and multiply with the numerator at the beginning of the period. And since I have chosen the special numerator, the numerator does not appear inside the expectation. It will appear outside the expectation. So here the numerator outside the expectation is N of little t. This will be the guy which is here. Yeah. So that is just the multiplied with numerator. So in the previous version of the proof, this guy here is the multiplied with numerator. Okay, so now let's look inside of the expectation. Inside the expectation, there is the value of the coupon payment, the floater. So that is the notional multiplied with bond at the beginning minus bond at the end, divided by bond at the end, fixed in the beginning of the period. So my fixing time is the beginning of the period. So which color can I use here? So maybe I take this light green here. So the fixing time here is the beginning of the period. And that is my little rate L multiplied with the period length. So that stuff here inside is the L of TI plus one multiplied with the period length. And now observe that actually what is inside this looks as if we divide a portfolio of bond at the beginning minus bond at the end with a numerator at the beginning of the period. So you see that this is exactly as in the previous proof, what you have inside this expectation can be reinterpreted as the evaluation of the portfolio at the beginning of the period. And now we know that these guys here, P of TK divided by N. So now, due to my stupid mistake with the ambiguity, I'm not allowed to just write it without the T. Yeah, so observed at any time. So maybe I take a different parameter here. Observed at some time, say S divided by N of S is a martingale. This is a QN martingale. It's a traded product divided by the numerator, and the assumption is I know an equivalent martingale measure such that all traded products are martingales. So that is now a heavy machinery I'm using to value this, but I just want to give you the links. So this is a martingale. So you see that you can apply now the universal pricing theorem and have that this gives you the value at evaluation time, little t, by just having the bond at the beginning divided by the numerator and the bond at the end divided by the numerator. And so we get the same formula. So the numerator is here canceling. So it's bond at the beginning minus bond at the end. But with your L, it is then L multiplied with the bond at the end. So you see there is some relation between the L and the bond that pays one unit at the end. That was maybe a very suitable numerator. We will recover this later again. So that sometimes there is a very suitable numerator. So also this is something that you do not understand or learn if you look at Black-Scholes model for stocks. It is not so prominent there. Here it is that choosing a numerator is actually important. For some problems, there is a special numerator that makes things easy. So that was now the value of the floater. The floater was just the coupon payments. So the floating rate bond is now just the object that pays a unit notional at the end. Okay, valuation is now trivial. It is the floater plus the zero coupon bond that pays at the end. So if we go back, since the value of the coupon payments is the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. If you have an additional payment at Tn, it is plus a bond that pays at the end, and the value of the floating rate bond is just the bond that pays one unit at the beginning. Okay, so that is a floating rate bond. I have a time discretization, and now I pay the same amount like in the floater. So I pay just the forward rate for the period from TI to TI plus one, multiplied with the period length. And in addition, at the end of all periods, so in Tn, so if I plus one is equal to n. So at the end, I pay one unit. So then the value of this floater is just floating rate bond is just our notional. So everything was again multiplied with our scaling factor notional. It's just the value notional multiplied zero coupon bond at the beginning. So this means, for example, the following. Yeah, so let's draw a little picture here. So I have now the payments, say, okay, let's draw a time discretization T1, T2. So these are my TIs and so on. Okay, and here is TN. And we have floating coupon payments, so stochastic coupon payments. So I don't know how the coupon payments are. Actually, not in the first period, so that one goes away. So at T2, T3, yeah, it's always paying at the end of the period. Okay, so then we know that the value of this at an earlier point in time, so I assume now I'm here in little t, so the value of this red stuff is the bond at the beginning, so in T1, observed in little t, minus the bond at the end of little t. So then I add another payment of, say, one unit at the end. So there's a one here. So then the value is plus the bond that pays at the end. Okay, so then you see that these guys here cancel. So I now consider, so you see the value of this object is the bond that pays one unit in T1. So if little t moves to, say, T1, the value of these payments at this point here is one. Okay, so at this point, the value is one. It's PT1 observed in T1, PT1, T1 is one. The zero coupon bond that pays one unit here. So if you pay a one here, so assume that I have a payment of one, so you buy this future cash flow, you buy it. So actually this is now here a minus one. So actually, since my arrow is going down, maybe I should write one. Yeah, so this is a minus one. So I pay one and I pay the blue one and I receive the red and the green one. So this would mean that I then have the minus upfront payment of a T1 bond. Then it means that the whole box here. So it means that the value of this box of future cash flows, minus one in T1, then floating payments between T2 and TN, and one unit in TN is zero. Yeah. So the value at any little t is zero for little t before T1. So it means that the red lines, the floating rate payments, are exactly the payments that compensate for having a difference in the blue and the green payment. Okay, they are the correct compensation for time going on between paying and receiving the money. So that is now the floating rate bond or the floater. Yeah, here you have it a bit nicer. And that was what I just said. So I already used the word fixing date and payment date. So let's have a small definition. Yeah. So the fixing date is when I fix the payment. So it is the date actually that defines the measurability of the object that I pay. And the payment date is then the date at which I do this payment. And if we apply the universal pricing theorem, so if we apply risk neutral valuation, then they occur inside this expectation operator. So it is that the fixing date is actually here given by the measurability of this object that I pay. And the payment date determines the numerator that we use. So it is in some other speech that is counting. Yeah, the numerator that we use to rebase this value. And then we perform evaluation. So it means that we perform conditional expectation. And actually, if I want to do evaluation, I have to multiply with the numerator at evaluation time to get the value. Yeah, because values divided by numerator are martingales. Huh? So I have to multiply with this to get the value. So this is here the evaluation. So fixing date is the measurability of the object that I pay. Payment date is then entering into the numerator. And you already saw that I was using in the first version of this proof a certain trick. And that trick is maybe you can call it that I can move the payment date to a different time such that the evaluation stays the same. Yeah? So if you have now in my speech with fixing date and payment date, if you have a fixing date T1 and a payment date T2, so I consider the payment of VT1, which is T1 measurable, paid in T2, yeah. So then by definition, you know the value in T2. So this here is the value in T2, because the value is just the payment itself, because it is paid in T2. But I can move this to a different point in time by, okay, if this point in time is before the payment date, but after the fixing date, so in this interval, I can consider the payment as a constant in the sense that it is already fixed, it is FT1 measurable. Then its equivalent value at an earlier point in time is that value multiplied with a zero coupon bond paying in T2 observed in little t. So receiving VT1 of T2 in T2 has the same value as receiving VT1 of T2 multiplied with the zero coupon bond observed in little t in little t. So I can move the value from, say, this point here, which is T2, to an earlier point, say, little t, which is here, by multiplying with the zero coupon bond price T2 observed in little t. Of course, I also can move the value to a later point. Yeah? I can move it to this point here. So that here is little t and that is another little t. I can move it also to this point by taking this value and dividing by the zero coupon bond that matures in little t observed in T2. So this is an FT2 measurable random variable. So it will make the payment now FT2 measurable. Okay, but why is that? Okay, because you can just apply this backward. If you multiply this with the zero coupon bond p little t observed in T2, you can go backward to the point T2. So you can also create this payment here. Pay VT1 of T2 multiplied with 1 divided by the Sirokoba bond. Paying 1 unit in little t observed in T2. And this has also the same value at any earlier point in time, so any point before T2, than the original payment. So I used actually this little trick that I can use Sirokoba bonds to move the payment to a different time, as long as I do not cross this line. Yeah, so I'm not allowed to cross this line here, because before this line, the object is stochastic. Yeah? So after, it is a random variable, which is FT1 measurable. So in this sense, it is then known. Yeah? It is, I see it as a constant. Okay, so that is a useful trick, but actually it is just valid in the context of valuation. Yeah. So for valuation, if you consider valuation, this trick holds. So, and it follows just as we did it in the proof of the floater, and the last one is just the inverse. Why is this trick useful? When is it useful? Well, there is a small remark here. If you have two payments at the same time, you can actually take the sum of the two payments and value just the sum. Because we assume that we have this linearity, this additivity of payments. Yeah. But this does not hold if the two payments are made at a different point, at two different points in time. Yeah? So if you have, say, a payment here, so that is VT1, and then, so maybe that one, okay. And then maybe, or let's say, just call it V1. I have a payment here that is V1. So this is a time axis here. Then I have another payment, and this another payment is maybe negative here. It's at the same time, and this another payment is V2. Then you can just take the net amount. Yeah, it is the green minus the blue, and this is just the net amount that you like to pay. So I can actually just take a look at take V1, and then you have plus V2. Okay, and you can just do that. And if you have another payment which is here, say V3, then you cannot just add V3. So that is not allowed. Okay, so yeah, of course, why it is not allowed? Because paying the two objects at a different time, I have to somehow attribute for the difference in time. Yeah? So I cannot add the two objects. So I could now use here the little trick of moving the payment date to the same time, and then I can add the corresponding values, because this trick is creating a different payment that corresponds to having the same value. So we can generalize this a little bit. So the object, or let me just maybe mark this here. So two payments with different payment time, taking the sum is not meaningful. Yeah, so it's not additive if they have different times. Yeah, but there is an object that is additive. So maybe I skip this first. No, it's here. Yeah, there is an object that is additive, and it is, instead of considering the payments, we consider the relative payments or the relative prices. So if we consider relative prices. So relative prices means I divide by the numerator. Okay, so relative price means I divide by the numerator. It means that I take V divided by the numerator. Then I can add V divided by the numerator for different payments, because these guys will have different payment times in their numerator. It will be VT1 divided by the numerator at T2. And it will be maybe V something else divided by the numerator at T3. So actually the division of the numerator is removing the dependency from time. If I'm in the context of risk-neutral valuation, so in the context of risk-neutral valuation, relative prices are additive, okay? And the reason is just that the expectation operator, which we use to evaluate cash flow, is a linear operator, yeah? So the expectation of a sum is the sum of the expectations. So this is a very useful thing, yeah, and it's maybe the generalization of this trick moving the payment date, and you see it here. If you have little t is larger than t1, yeah, so you have a payment vt1 that is ft1 measurable, and you pay this in t2, and if you perform the evaluation with respect to little t, you can move this guy out of the expectation, yeah, because it is ft1 measurable and t1 is before little t, right? This is conditional expectation little t, and you see that this object here is just the zero Cooper bond. Okay, that's the trick, that I multiply with the zero Cooper bond to get the equivalent value at a different point in time. Okay, so I can take the sum of relative prices. And that's the reason why often in the computer, when you implement valuations, you always divide by the numerator at the corresponding point in time, and then you perform summation and aggregate all these payments. Maybe a small remark here. This is, well, warning is a little bit too much. Yeah, a small remark. This additivity of cash flows is here in our context, it's valid, but it's not always valid. It depends a little bit on the on your context. So if you have, for example, counterparty default, and I pay, say, 10 euro to some other guy, and the other guy has to pay 8 euro to me, it looks as if it's 10 minus 8, yeah, so I have just to pay 2 euros, yeah? So, but now what's happening if the other guy is going bankrupt? Yeah? So does he now get only the net amount, so only the 2 euros, or does he get my 10 euros, but I don't get his money? And that really depends on some legal issues. So this is if there is some kind of netting agreement in place. And actually, if you don't have such a netting agreement, it is the latter part, that you have to pay the full 10 euro, but you don't get back the money from him, yeah? So if somebody goes bankrupt, the company will receive all its asset, and then the guy decides who's getting the money or not. So there are some legal issues, but now we are in an idealized world, and we can add cash flows which happen on the same time, and we can add relative prices that happen on different times. So let's continue with defining more interest rate products. So I have now floating rate payments, I have fixed rate payments, and the most popular interest rate product is the swap. And the swap is just the exchange of the two payments. So the definition of a swap is that we exchange payments, we exchange a floating rate. So here I have a floating rate L. So we call this the floating rate, which is exchanged against a fixed amount S, which we call the fixed rate. So fixed rate because everything is multiplied with the period length. So this here is the fixed rate multiplied with the period length TI minus TI plus one minus TI. So in this product here, actually I receive L and I pay S. So because it is positive for me, L is positive for me. So if you receive or pay, it depends on the definition. And also it depends if the notional is positive or negative. Yeah? So here it is L minus S. The swap that goes the other way around has either a negative N, yeah, or you flip the definition. So if I view this from my point of view, minus is that I lose money, I have to pay it. And for that reason, this guy here is called the payer swap, because you always look at the fixed side that has to be paid. The reason why you look always at the fixed side, maybe it's just convention, but we already saw that paying floating rate is like a little bit paying just the natural thing. And the value of the floating rate bond with the upfront payment was zero. So the fixed rate is actually that the object that is defining here the financial product. So that is the swap. 1 second. Okay. So it's just the exchange of the floating rate payment minus the fixed payment. And we can already value this because it is just a linear combination of two payments for which we already know the value. That's just the remark. If we have N times L minus S, it's sometimes called the payer swap with a positive notional because we pay the fixed side. And if I have S minus L, it is called the receiver swap. Okay, so this is an indication if you pay or receive the fixed coupon. The two sides of this exchange of the payment, they have a name. Yeah? So actually I can decompose this in one sequence paying the floating amounts and the other sequence paying or receiving the fixed amounts. So these sequence here say for all I, so I from 1 to n minus 1. This is called the floating leg, the float leg. So this here is called the float leg. And the fixed leg is then the payments or receivements of the fixed side. So actually you can decompose the exchange of L minus S into one leg, yeah, one sequence that is always paying L and the other sequence that is always receiving S or the other way around. So that is called the fixed leg. So just in case you hear these names. We can already evaluate this, paying the floating rate at time TI plus one. So I pay at the end of the period. It's the natural payment associated with this floating rate is just the floating rate at the valuation time. So here is valuation time. Paying the fixed rate is just the fixed rate. Everything multiplied with the zero coupon bond observed at payment time. Okay, that's just the value of the fixed coupon bond and the value of the floating rate bond. So actually the swap is just a floating rate bond minus a fixed coupon bond. So the swap consists of a floater, the float leg, and fixed payment, and both are already valued, so I know the value of the swap. Now there's a nice little question. Maybe I write this here. So assume all these SIs. So here in my definition of the swap, it's allowed that the fixed coupons are different for every period, but assume that all these guys are the same. They are just a single S. Then I would like to know for which S is the value of this financial product zero? So for which S is the value of the swap at time little t equal to zero? So let's draw a small picture of what's happening here. So we have the swap that pays or exchanges payments. So we have our periods. Here's the last one. So now I draw the exchange of the periods. Green is now my floating payment. Okay, and maybe my floating payment have different lengths here. So some are smaller, some are larger, okay. And now I have the fixed payment on the other side. So maybe I draw here a small helper line. So that little helper line here, which should be maybe dotted, and they all have the same amount. So they all have the same amount. Okay, it's a constant, it's S. Yeah? So that here is the S, and this one here is the LI, yeah? Floating every period different. And now I ask myself, okay, what is actually the value S here, such that the swap has value zero. So somehow this S should be a quantity that, well, maybe this one goes here. That one is maybe a little bit larger. Yeah, so that should be something, maybe that can be smaller now, okay. So this S is somehow like the average of the floating rate payments. So what is the value S for which this financial product has value zero? And we are asking us this question at a specific time t. So I'm asking this question in time t. So actually the answer to this question depends on t. So the answer to this question depends on t. So that means this S here depends on t. For which S of t is, so that should be an is the value of the swap zero. So there is a certain swap rate, so this object is called the swap rate, for which the swap has value zero. And this swap rate, of course, depends on the time at which I evaluate the swap. So this swap rate S of t is another form of an interest rate. It's somehow the average interest rate for floating rate periods given a certain tenor structure, given a certain time discretization. So that leads now to another definition, the swap rate. So here you have this, what I just made, again, yeah, so a little bit nicer. So what is the swap rate. SIS, such that in time little t, the swap has value 0. And this swap rate is then called the par swap rate. So par for putting this at a certain par level. Yeah, to answer this question, I just have to solve this equation. So we know that this here is the value of the swap. This should be equal to 0. So you see actually the notional doesn't enter, doesn't count. And you move now everything that contains the S to the other side. So that is the sum of S multiplied with the period length multiplied with the zero Cooper bond that pays in ti plus one. So I move that to the other side. So since it has a minus, it goes with a plus to the other side. Then you can move the s in front of the sum. And you can divide by this sum. So I divide by this sum. So this is here this sum. And what is left on the left-hand side is just the value of the floating leg. So this here is just the value of the floating leg. So the float leg was the sequence of payments of the floating rate. So it is the swap rate, which we're looking for, is the value of the floating leg divided by this sum, period length multiplied with zero Cooper bonds. So that's a portfolio of zero Cooper bonds. And this gives us now our swap rate S of T. Okay, so observe that this guy depends on the little t here. Yeah, because the little t appeared in the evaluation formula. You know that the value of the floating leg is actually a telescope sum in our idealized setup. So it is the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. So the swap rate is the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end divided by this sum of zero Cooper bonds in between everyone weighted with the period length. So that is now another interest rate, a very important interest rate, the swap rate. And you know that the definition of the swap rate, so now we define here the swap rate, depends, of course, on this time discretization. Actually, we will later maybe generalize this. So both legs can have different time discretizations. Yeah, there are some trivial generalizations. But here, it's just one time discretization for both legs. And the definition of the swap rates depends here on this, because it will actually occur here in this object. And this object also has a name. It is called this portfolio of zero Cooper bonds by which you divide here. So actually the portfolio that is then multiplied with the rate in the swap, this is called the swap annuity. Okay, so this interest rate is somehow a little, something so from this picture here, it is something like an average of the forward rates. And you can also just show this. It is a convex combination of the forward rates. So you see here, it is the forward rate multiplied with some weight, and the weight is the zero Cooper bond price multiplied with the period length, divided by the sum of all these weights. So it is like a weighted sum divided by the sum of the weights. So it is the weighted sum of all the forward rates, and the weights are the bond corresponding to the period end of this forward rate multiplied with the period length divided by the sum of all those bonds multiplied with the period length. So that was now the swap rate. Okay, so I have a small proof of this, just a small calculation. Yeah, let me finish by generalizing the definition of the swap a little bit. So the swap which we have seen now was a little bit idealized because I used one tenor discretization, one time discretization for both legs, T1, T2, T3. Yeah. Actually, in practice, swaps are a little bit more general than the product that we have defined here. So each leg can have its own properties, like its own time discretization, its own day count convention, and so on. So, but that's just a very simple idealization. So what we, or generalization, sorry, what we define is a swap leg. And a swap leg now pays some index plus an additional constant, which I call here a spread, yeah, multiplied with the period length. And the period discretization is, as before, Ti to Ti plus one. But now I can fix this index at another fixing time. So the fixing time is Tif. And I can pay this index at some other payment time. So the payment time is now Tip. And usually the fixing time for the forward rate is the beginning of the period plus minus a few days. And the payment time is the end of the period, usually plus a few days. But for example, we will also now consider the backward rate. So the swap on the backward looking rate. Yeah. Then of course the fixing time is the end of the period. Payment date is still the end of the period. Okay, you can just generalize this. And whether you have a floating leg or a fixed leg is just given by if this quantity is zero or not, or if this index here is just zero or something else. So I just need this generalized definition of a swap leg, and then I can say that a swap is just a difference of two legs. So a swap is just two swap legs, one with notional n and one with notional minus n. Okay, so let me finish this session. Yeah, it's time to finish the session. So what I will do in the next session is the swap on the backward rate and the overnight index swap. Yeah, it's just 15 minutes more and we are actually done with the swaps. And to conclude this session, I will also comment again on static replication. So the trick that we have also used in the proof of the floater theorem, that we can find a portfolio that has exactly the value of the stuff that we pay. And we perform static replication for the swap on the backward rate and for the swap on the forward rate. And then we start with some nonlinear products. Yeah, so these products are sometimes called linear products because you can just value them without a model. That's it. Thanks.